Thank you very much. And the catalyst is letting it out and go free.
Next up, teacher in residence, Tammy Cook Endries.
Yay, Tammy!
Batting third, senior educator Lori Lambertson. And last but never least, senior educator Eric Muller. So they are all ready to show down, and we are about to be ready to show you today's secret ingredient, which is below this beautiful cloth.
Ready?
What could it be? The hint for today's secret ingredient is it is the most important meal of the day. What do you think that might be? Not quite. Any other guesses? Yes.
Breakfast.
Let's see if he's right. Let's do the unveiling. Today's secret ingredient is milk, bagels, eggs, donuts, cereal, oatmeal. Looks like breakfast to me. So contestants, get ready. On your mark, get set. Make some science.
Sure.
All right, we have Ron taking a look at Tammy Cook Endries, who is opening a bottle of vinegar. Tammy grabs some eggs out of the basket, and so what might she be doing with that vinegar? It looks like she's pouring some vinegar over the eggs. And when we look inside that beaker, you may notice that some bubbles are forming on the eggs. So maybe Tammy will tell us about what is going on. Tammy grew up in a household where her father worked for a cereal company, so she grew up eating Lucky Charms that had either too few or too many marshmallows. We will see if she is lucky or charmed today to become the Iron Science teacher. Next up, we're taking a look at Lori Lambertson, who has done a taste test of her cereal, I think. Thumbs up or down. She had some frosted shredded wheat that she is crunching up and tasting, very tasty. It is lunchtime here at the Exploratorium, so Lori needs a little sustenance. Lori's trying to get that cereal crushed up as much as possible. I wonder what she's gonna do with it. She's reaching down for some water. Normally we eat cereal with milk, but Lori is a pretty healthy eater, so perhaps she prefers her cereal with water. Lori is also an avid surfer. We will see if she can surf her way to a win today. Next up, we're taking a look at Paul Doherty, who is taking some Cheerios. He picked the box of Cheerios and putting them in a box that's full of water. And you may notice that he's carefully dropping the Cheerios and many of them are staying on top. Paul is a chipper guy, which is probably why he picked Cheerios. He is also an avid rock climber, so we will see if he too can climb his way to a win in today's Iron Science teacher. Our favorite mess maker is in the corner already, taking an egg that he has boiled. So he put on a pot of water, and now he has quickly boiled an egg, and he is peeling it. He has some milk. Boiling an egg in milk. Maybe. Eric is known for his array of explosive activities. We will see what he has for us today. In an earlier life, Eric was a river rafting guide, so we will see if he can guide himself to a win today. All All right, contestants, make sure you have everything together. We need music? Okay, here we go. The countdown's coming on. Paul is confident, ready, making the plan in his head. At this point, it's all mental, Paul. Tammy's getting her gloves on, making sure everything looks good. What's happened to those eggs? All right, we're counting down. The first iron science teacher prep period is over. So give them a hand, everyone. They prepped a whole science lesson in that amount of time. And then I'll say the Teacher Institute celebrated its 30th birthday earlier this week. This is the 31st summer that we're running a Teacher Institute. And first up, the man who I believe has participated in more Iron Science teacher competitions than anyone else, teaching the High School Institute this summer, senior scientist Paul Doherty.
The most important way to start a day is with science. So here I am at breakfast. I've got these Cheerios in the water. I'm gonna have Ron come over, and you're gonna be able to see the Cheerios on the big screen. And as you look at these, the thing about science and mathematics is the search for patterns and regularity. So as we look down on these, as I look down on them, I noticed something. Maybe you notice it too. There are no lonely Cheerios. They always love each other, or they love the sides. They all go to the sides. Well, I guess there's the one and the couple in the corner, but there's none just floating around solo. So I thought, well, I've got to investigate this. What is attracting those Cheerios to each other? So I take my little Cheerio herder, a plastic fork, and I can push one out of the crowd, and we'll just see what happens here as it goes around. And if it gets near anything, like the edge, it accelerates. Wham! Right into the edge.
Amazing.
Amazing. So I thought, what could make those Cheerios attract each other? Electrostatics. No, I took a charged comb and put it, you can take something charged like this fork, and you comb it through whatever hair you have left. And then you put it over there, and you find out that that's not electrostatics, and it's not magnetism. What other force of nature is left? The strong nuclear force. No, Cheerios are not nuclear yet. And gravity could be it. You see, the Cheerios are floating. When I push them down, they come back up. They just come back up. They float. And water wets them. And when water wets things, it crawls up the sides. So each one of those Cheerios, as Ron can catch the lighting around it, each one of those Cheerios is affecting the shape of the water around it. See the little rings of light around each one when he gets the light right? So the water is crawling up the sides of those Cheerios. And the Cheerios are floating. Floating things want to sit high in the water. Get this. Each Cheerio has a pile of water around it where it goes up higher. They can actually float higher, go up, if they float up each other's hill. And on the side, there's a meniscus. The water rolls up the side. And so they can float higher by rolling up each other's hill. Well, that's a great hypothesis in science, but you've got to do some experiments. So I thought, if that's the case, I could bring over, whoops, sorry about that. I could bring over a bigger tray of water, and instead of having Cheerios for breakfast, I could have Hungarian coins known as filler, okay? These are Hungarian coins, and what you do, any aluminum coin in the world, you take a fork and you lower it into water, and it floats on the water. You can see the curvature of the water around it. This coin, unlike the Cheerios, it's not floating because it's less dense. When I push this coin down, it stays down. Aluminum is denser than water. It's a floater. So I'll get rid of that floater. And now we'll find out if I'm right and I float a couple of coins side by side. Each one makes a hole in the water. And if they get close at all, if I get them close, they should accelerate towards each other.
Amazing.
Each falling into the other's hole. I call this the valley bed phenomena. You go into a nice soft bed with someone else, you sit there, you sink into the bed. What happens? You roll towards each other. Two bowling balls on a trampoline, what do? They roll towards each other. So, I've got these coins, which fall into each other's depression in the surface of the water, and if they go down, they go down for good. Try another one. So you have to be pretty careful. You got to lower them right in flat. So these are like water striders. You know those insects that just walk on the surface of water? They're just like this. And look at that. It forms a nice little crystal. So now I've got to do my test. If I'm really right, and the Cheerios are going to where the water is the highest, around other Cheerios which are floating and around the meniscus on the edge, what's a Cheerio going to do when it comes to a hole in the water? Will it be attracted or be repelled? Think about that. Da, 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 da. Okay, how many think it's going to be attracted? How many think it's going to be repelled? How many are waiting to see what the answer is? Okay, I thought so. All right, here we go. So I don't have to, there we go, put that in there. So I'm going to get it over fairly close to these coins. Here we go. I'll push it in. And wait a minute. Here, get closer. Go in there. Go in there. Really, go in there. Ah, it's bouncing away. It bounces away. So those of you who voted repel are right. So, yeah. So my hypothesis is beginning to look pretty good here. That floating things like to float up, and including whenever the water curves up, they'll float up it. And they'll attract, and they'll make these beautiful crystal patterns. So next time you're ready for breakfast with Cheerios, you can do experiments with wetting and gravity. But then, of course, I thought, this is iron science, teacher. Bigger is better. Cheerios, an O, a floating O. Donuts.
The fuel of the Teacher Institute
the
staff.
The fuel of the Teacher Institute staff. So I'm going to put a donut in here and float the donut, whatever floats your donut. And I'll put a second donut in there. Now, two objects that are identical, the coins both sank and they attracted. The Cheerios both floated and they attracted. The two donuts are going to be the same. Let's see what happens. Oh, look at that. If I pull them apart a little bit and I let go, they drift apart. let me gently get them close. Here we go. Okay, there they go. You can see they accelerate towards each other. Well, it turns out this effect, which I'm going to name the Cheerio effect, works great on small things, but it's really weak on big things. So what I suggest is, for breakfast, do science, float the Cheerios, but eat the donuts. So there you go,
thanks.
Floating Cheerios.
Thanks. That was Paul Doherty showing us how Cheerios work together to float their way to the top. Thanks, Paul. Next up, we have Tammy Cook Endres, who's running our leadership program this summer. Tammy looked ecstatic that the secret ingredient was breakfast this morning.
All right. So, I have a couple of favorite things in the world. One of them is eggs. So I was super excited about the Iron Science Teacher breakfast. So this is a regular egg. Look pretty familiar?
Yeah.
Okay. These, so it doesn't roll off the table there. These are eggs that I put in vinegar. What do you notice happening on these eggs? We're getting real close there. What do you see happening there?
Bubbles. Bubbles.
Bubbles. Does anybody know what's inside these bubbles? What do you think?
Oxygen.
Oh, that is a great guess, because oxygen is a gas, right? And it forms in bubbles. Any other guesses?
One moment.
Oh, she's going to give you the microphone in 1 second. Sorry, I picked somebody way back there.
Calcium.
Ooh, that is a good guess, too. You know what calcium is going to break off of here, because there is calcium in the eggshell, but it's actually not calcium. That's usually in a solid, or it's in an ion, so it'll dissolve in there. This is actually carbon dioxide. What happens when you put eggs in vinegar is the shell actually dissolves. And this is pretty cool. And if I left these here for a couple days, I would have something more like this. I need to check this out. I'm going to give you a... There were a few volunteers that I had asked before the show. Can you raise your hands just so I can... Okay, you each get a glove. There you go. And I had two girls over here, and then I had a boy right there.
Are they coming up, Tammy?
They are not coming up. Okay. I'm going to come to them. Sorry, it got crowded up here. And we're going to pass one back to this gentleman back
volunteers.
Here.
Volunteers, tell me your name.
My name is Alia.
Alia, where are you from?
Spartanburg.
Welcome, Alia from Spartanburg.
Colin. Roswell, New Mexico.
Roswell, New Mexico.
Oh,
nice to meet you, Colin.
Very cool place.
Who else do we have here helping Tammy out? Tell me your name.
Megan, and I'm from Austin, Texas.
Austin, Texas.
Oh,
I'm a Texan,
very nice.
Too.
Natalie.
Natalie.
Austin, Texas.
Also from Austin. I'm going to guess
you guys are
together. And
we have a gentleman back here. Do you want to say your name
more.
Really loud?
Hi, who are you?
Timothy.
Where are you from, Timothy?
Richmond.
Timothy from Richmond.
Awesome.
Thanks to
Richmond.
All of our volunteers.
So what you're going to have here, and we're going to pass it back to Timothy as soon as you're done, okay? This is an egg where I've taken the shell off. Yeah? It's... Oh, dear. That's bad. Okay.
Let's get some paper towels. Right. Tammy, you know Tammy's an experienced
prepared.
Teacher because she came prepared with towels.
And Tammy has a five-year-old. So, okay. I am so sorry. And Tammy needs to give some more warning. So what I'm going to have you do this time is I'm actually going to hold it, and I'm going to have you touch it real quick. And Timothy, why don't you come up here, hon? Can you reach way up here?
Timothy, just give that a little touch and let us know
just
how it feels.
Touch. Oh, not too hard. There we go. All right. So I'm going to do some of the touching, too. So this is an egg with no shell. What I love about eggs is they are actually a good model for a human cell. There's a big difference, though, between an egg and a human cell, and that is the size. So there's other differences, too, but the size is a big one. There are a lot of cells in the human body.
How many cells are there?
Does anybody know what this number is?
A lot.
Whoa! If you are a grown-up of average size, which I am not, but if you're an average-sized human, you're going to have about 3 trillion cells in your human body. So you do not have 3 trillion this size. So what I decided to do, because it acts kind of like a human cell, is I like to study what goes in and out of cells. It makes me very excited. So I took some different treatments, and I stuck my, what we call naked eggs, my eggs without shells, in these different treatments.
So Tammy soaked the eggs in vinegar and then rubbed the shells off because the vinegar ate away at the shells.
Yeah. So I'm going to show you a couple different things that are kind of cool. One of the treatments that I did was really salty water. So I poured as much salt as would dissolve into an egg, and it kind of looks like the other egg. I can show it to you. That would probably be better. Okay. So this looks pretty much like the other egg, but there's something funny about it. Have you ever broken open a raw egg? Have you seen what that looks like? Yeah.
Alia has.
Yeah. That's one of those things. Okay. So this is actually going to look a little bit different. And if you can see on here, this is the yolk. And I'm pushing on that pretty hard. Does that look like a normal yolk to you? No. It's pretty hard. And this part's all, it's kind of gooey. I'm going to show you another one. So this is the very salty egg. I'm going to put that over here. This is an egg that I put not in salty water, but just in pure salt. Sorry, I know, I'm sorry.
A salt-encrusted naked egg.
Yeah? All right. And this one. Oh, wow. Okay, so this is the yolk. Do you see that? And then this is the white. Kind of gross. I'm going to show you another one that's my favorite.
Alia wants to know why you didn't give her that one to break.
That would have been much kinder. I'm going to help you clean up afterwards. I am so sorry. That was in the name of science, right? Yeah. Tell your science teacher they'll give you extra credit. Okay, so this is corn syrup. And you probably saw that it was really just saggy and gross. And this is the yolk, and then this is the white. And then there's another one I want to show you, and that's one I put in water. Huh. That one looks pretty different than those other ones. Let's see what's going on in here. Whoa. Okay, so that one, you can see the normal egg in there, but what else do you see on the side here? What do you think all
that
is?
What does it look like on the outside of that membrane?
Yeah, that's a lot of water. And then there's one more I want to show you. And this one I soaked in isopropyl alcohol, which is the kind of alcohol you probably have in your bathrooms. What do you notice about that one?
Tammy, did you take the shell off of that one?
I did. You can see because it's, sorry, Ron. There you go. It's pretty squishy, right? It almost looks like a hard-boiled egg. Let's see what's inside.
Soft okay. Boil.
So now what's
favorite.
Really weird about this is I actually did not hard-boil this egg. This is a raw egg just like the other one. But it looks pretty different, and we're going to talk about that in just a second. I wanted to show you one thing. And that is something I like to call, actually, I didn't name this. This is called osmosis. I think I'm just going to put this right here.
That's what this was.
All right. So when you have a cell, stuff moves in and stuff moves out. And one of the things that moves really easily through that outside part of the cell called the cell membrane is water. Yeah. And whenever water moves through a membrane, we call that osmosis. So what you see out over here is what I had for most of the eggs. I had a lot of stuff, that's a very scientific word, stuff, dissolved stuff, on the outsides of the cell. And on the inside of the cell, there's a little bit of dissolved stuff, but there's also a lot of water. So in cases like corn syrup and salt and salty water, I had something like this. And what happens is when you have these dissolved solids, water gets really attracted to those. And so the water kind of sticks like this and sticks like this, kind of like that. There's not a lot of free water to move around here. But if you look over here, yeah, I've got some water stuck on here and some water stuck on here. But check out all this free water. And water molecules are constantly bouncing around and bouncing around. So they get knocked back and forth. So what eventually happens is a lot of my water actually ends up, it's supposed to go through the holes, but for speed, I'm going to just skip right over the membrane. And I end up with a lot of water leaving my cell. In fact, I end up with a whole lot of water leaving my cell, and it ends up over here. So what you saw is this cell that has been almost emptied of water. And so when you saw that really dry yolk and that really gooey egg yolk, that's what you saw. It lost a lot of water. The only time that didn't happen was with what treatment? Do you remember what treatment the water did not leave?
When did it
when
seem
I put it
more
in water,
watery inside?
Yeah? And so in that one, I actually had none of this red stuff on the outside, and I had only the blue stuff, which is my water. And now, what we call the concentration of the water is actually higher on the outside than on the inside. And guess what happens? The water's gonna go that way. So that, my friends, is osmosis.
Thank you. That's Tammy Cook Endres showing how osmosis works inside and outside of a naked egg. I thought that was pretty excellent, didn't you? All right, next up, teaching the Middle School Summer Institute this year, here she is, Lori Lambertson.
Hello, everybody. Let's see, what am I going to do? I'm going to move around somewhere. Maybe I'll go this way, Ron.
Can I be helpful?
Oh, okay. Thanks. I prepared some slides for today. Not typical of me. So I was really happy to see that this was breakfast cereal because I am one of those people that cannot skip breakfast. I have to eat breakfast every day. And one of the reasons we eat food is, that's not food in there. We eat food because we can get macronutrients from it. Macronutrients like protein and fats and carbohydrates, and also micronutrients like vitamins and minerals. And I'm really interested in iron in my cereal. And so I know that iron in our food can come in two forms. There's heme iron, which comes from meat, poultry, and fish. And there's also non-heme iron. Next slide, please. Whenever. Non-heme iron comes from non-meat sources, particularly good sources of iron for those of us who don't eat meat. I am one of you. Are beans and leafy greens. And fortified cereals are another source of non-heme iron. And so today's cereal that we're using is Safeway's Frosted Mini Wheats. Next slide. Frosted Shredded Wheat. This stuff, and I took a picture of the side so that you can see that this is a really high iron content fortified cereal. Next slide, please. This cereal, one serving of this cereal, provides 90% of the iron you need. Yeah, how about that? So I want to see how our body metabolizes iron, and in order to do that, I made a model of the digestive system. Next slide, please. And my model of the digestive system comes with food in it.
Because you had breakfast this morning.
Because I had breakfast this morning. And so I wanted you to see how we metabolize breakfast. So I ate my cereal this morning 4 or 5 hours ago. And it doesn't sit in your stomach for 4 or 5 hours. But I had to prepare this, right? So food goes down the esophagus, the mouth, and your saliva, break it down, add more fluids. When it gets into the stomach, more fluid is added, and the food is broken down even more. After 4 or 5 hours, you know, I had breakfast like 4 or 5 hours ago, the food is going to pass from the stomach into the small intestine. And so I have a little a sphincter here, which I have to get rid of so that this can move along. Because it has, Eric's going to help me not make a mess. Ha. So peristalsis, can you hold this end right here?
For some reason, Lori has chosen Eric Muller to help her not make
a mess. Oh, my gosh. So I'm going to move this food along out of the stomach by peristalsis into the small intestine. So after 4 or 5 hours, the stomach is empty. It takes about 4 or 5 hours for your stomach to empty into the small intestine. Well, it turns out this first section of the small intestine, the duodenum, is where most of our minerals and vitamins are absorbed. And so I wanted to do a little absorption experiment here. Eric's going to help me not make the world's biggest mess. I've already made the world's biggest mess several times today. You should see my office. So this is cereal that I, you know, I've been digesting for a while. Oh, I need my scissors. I want to see if there's some iron in my cereal. So I've got a magnet here, got my small intestine that I'm going to open up. Okay, normally in the body, there are channels through which the iron can pass. Iron passes out of the small intestine. Iron passes out of the small intestine and into the plasma. Some of it's stored in the epithelial layers of the intestine, but most of the iron in the body is in the form of hemoglobin.
Lori, what's the magnet for?
Well, the magnet, I'm trying to get some of that iron, because, you know, I know that this cereal, how gross is this? That's pretty gross. Okay. Let's see if we got any iron. Thanks, Eric. So if there's any iron in my cereal, it might be stuck to this magnet. I'm going to rinse the magnet because the pieces of iron will stick to it even if I dip it in water. So I'm just dipping this. I'm not trying to make it. I'm not wiping it or anything. And I'm going to use somebody who's up close. Do you see any little bits of iron on there? See anything black?
Yeah.
We have verification from the front row that there are black bits of iron.
I can push these around a little bit. Oh my goodness.
What?
There is iron in that cereal. So, let's talk a little bit about the iron that came out of the cereal. Should I eat some more cereal? No. Can I see my slides again? What slide were we on? Hey, so iron is in a molecule called a heme. Next slide, please. And that is incorporated. Did I lose something? Oh, yeah, when I took that off. Now you can hear me again. Yeah. And next slide, please. In the bone marrow are red blood cells, and the precursors to our red blood cells take that iron in the form of the heme and incorporate it into a really, really important molecule called hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is super important because it carries oxygen to every part of your body. Next slide, please. This is what hemoglobin looks like. There are four hemes in one hemoglobin molecule. Each heme can bind a single oxygen molecule. So each hemoglobin can carry four oxygens. And this is how we get oxygen when we breathe it in through our lungs. This is how oxygen is carried through all parts of our body. Super important. How much iron is in our body? Well, I'm going to show you. An adult human might have between 3 and 4 grams of iron in their body. So here's 3.5 grams of nails. That's how much iron is in your entire body in an adult. About 2.4 grams of that is in hemoglobin, in your blood. So most of the iron in our body is in hemoglobin. So how much blood would that be? I know you want to know. Ooh. So a 70-kilogram man. Who weighs 70 kilograms here? Paul Doherty is our sample 70-kilogram man. So Paul Doherty has 5 liters of blood. That's how much blood is in somebody Paul's size. And in that blood, he's got 2.4 grams of iron in the form of hemoglobin. What else did I need to tell you? Have you set off a metal detector recently, Paul?
Nope. Wrong kind of iron.
Yeah, wrong kind of iron. And I don't know if I have any more slides. I have one more. Hey, so there are those red blood cells carrying the iron to all parts of your body so that you will have oxygenated muscles and tissues and everything else. So that's iron in your cereal. And
let's hear it for Lori Lambertson. Thought that teaching us about iron would help her win Iron Science T-shirt.
I did have an entire length of intestine just to show you that that's a small intestine. It's a busy place. So we have about 25 centimeters of esophagus, about 25 centimeters of stomach, about 6 meters of small intestine. That's the bunchy part here. And then about 1.5 meters of large intestine to pass a meal through the entire 8-meter system is variable, but on average, it's about 30 hours. All right, there you go.
There you go, a little duodenum as an addendum. All right, Lori has left the master of the mess a mess. A little sabotage for Eric.
I get
but please welcome the man who is co-leading the High School Institute. You know him, you love him, Eric Mahler.
How many times has this happened to you?
Am I?
So, oh, am I on?
I'm on. You are definitely on.
I'm on. I'm going to even start again. How many times has this happened to you? So, you like breakfast. How many of you like breakfast? How many of you like pandering to the crowd? Yeah, thank you. And you eat a lot of carbohydrates, but it's time to eat more protein. How many of you want to switch over to more protein? Okay, well, there you have it then. How many of you like to have food for breakfast that's stuffed inside of other food?
Stuffed food!
Yeah, pigs in a blanket. Chocolate croissants. Jelly-filled donuts. And how many of you like gas laws?
Yeah!
Okay, well, your wait for the solution to this problem is over. With the new Mulco. Egg in milk device. I need help. Hey, Mike, we don't know each other, do we? Come on up. We've never met before.
All right, let's give him a hand.
Come on around with this side.
We have another volunteer for Eric. Mike, tell us your name.
Mike.
And where are you from?
Amon Jordan.
And tell us what brought you here to the Exploratorium, Mike.
An airplane, a bus, and walking.
Actually,
Teacher Institute.
Mike is one of our great teachers participating in the Summer Institute. All the way from Jordan.
So what we need to do, Mike, is we have to get a hard-boiled egg. Can you peel this egg right here? Right over there.
Make sure it's not raw.
Okay, wait a minute. Okay, you can try the other egg. This one is raw. Here you go. Wrong one. Go ahead, try that one. Boo. Cruel.
Mike, I would sit down if I were you.
That one is it. Actually, this one might be okay. All my other eggs are not cooked enough, so I'm gonna see if I can get a more cooked egg. This one might be it. So, what we're gonna do is we're gonna get an egg inside of this milk bottle.
No way.
What way? Using milk. Okay, how's that coming along?
Getting there.
All right. So, as Ron will attest.
I will attest.
He needs his safety equipment. Oh, no, this one's a little bit raw, too. It's okay. It'll all work out.
Close.
Close.
We've graduated from a raw egg to a very soft-boiled egg.
You know what? I'm going to actually grab this one over here. Yeah, very soft-boiled. So it might feel a little better over here. So, thank you. Thank you for doing that.
Eric Mahler, everyone.
Wait. Hey, Mike, come on over here. So here is your job. I need to give you a pair of goggles, too. You're going to stand on this side. Here's your goggles. Hopefully those are big enough. Are they big enough? Yes or no? Yeah, they are. Okay, good. And actually, tell you what. I'll wear these too. And more safety equipment over here. Every home should be with one of these. So what we're going to do, Mike, is you are going to pour, where'd my milk go? Oh, right here. You're going to pour about a half a cup of the steaming hot milk inside of that jar right there. And I'll let you know when to stop. And
but
as soon as
the one with the glove.
And as soon as you're done. Oh, hey, by the way, before I start pouring it, don't you guys want to have an egg inside your milk that's whole? Yeah. Let's see if we can get this egg inside of the milk whole. Okay? So you're going to pour it in here. I'll tell you when to stop. And then as soon as you're done, I'm going to put this egg on top. Pour really carefully. Yeah, just about half of it. I mean, yeah, maybe a third of it. Okay, go ahead. Keep going. That's good right there. So you set it, and you don't forget it.
Oh! Indeed, an egg and milk.
Give me that one over there. Hey, right over here. Hold on.
Amazing!
Thank you very much. You guys want to see that again?
Yeah!
In slow motion? No, not in slow motion. So, what we're using is we're using air pressure to help push the egg in there. So we're using a gas law called Gay-Lussac's law, where when we put the hot milk inside of here, what happens to the air inside of there? It gets hot and it expands and it can't go anywhere. And so it wants to rush out the top. And I have a valve up there. And by the way, I actually, just in case, I got an egg from the restaurant. I'm plugging the restaurant. This is a pickled egg. This is a real pickled egg over from the restaurant. Go get them. They're actually pretty good. And so we're going to put this one-way valve on here again. Okay? What we're going to do is we're going to heat the air, let the air get really hot in there, rush out, and then it's going to cool back down. When it cools down, it's going to contract, and hopefully it's going to suck the egg in, but it's not really being sucked in. It's being pushed in by the outside atmosphere. You ready? Here we go.
More milk.
That's good. Ready? Okay, set it, but don't forget it. Let's see if this one will do it. Come on.
There it goes.
It's going almost kind of. Push
Indeed,
it.
Indeed, slow motion.
Yeah, very slow motion. And actually, if I had ice water, it would go faster. Yeah. Oh, you got water. Here you go. Here you go. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to cool the outside of the jar down. See if I can make the air inside get cooler. It's a pretty rugged egg, I'll tell you that. It's
pickled.
Is it going?
Egg.
What's that? Pickled eggs. Is it going? How many more minutes do I got?
-1.
Tell you what. Yeah, it's okay. Is it going? So anyways, that's how it works. I'll put this over here just in case. But you might be asking, how does this taste? It's great. But you also might be asking, let's see if I got it over here. Come on. How do you get that egg out of here? So, if I use air pressure to get it in here, how am I going to get it out of here? So what do you think I should do? Okay, you ready? I got to put more pressure on the backside of it to get it out. Oh!
Soft-boiled egg.
So if you like protein, make sure you get the egg and milk device by Molko.
Very
Anatoly
nice.
Gaslaus.
Let's
That's
hear
it.
For Eric Muller, who showed us how to make everyone's favorite smoothie, milk and hard-boiled egg. Slow motion, as promised. Too bad that didn't happen right as we were voting. All right, let's hear for all of the contestants today and our science teacher. I'm going to bring them back up here and remind you what they did on their way out. First, we had Paul Doherty, who showed us the Cheerio effect. Lori Lambertson, who taught us how to get the iron out of our cereal and what the iron does for us in the body. Tammy Cook-Endries coming up. She showed us the naked egg and osmosis. And Eric ended with egg in a bottle using gas laws to make milky boiled eggs. So I am now going to ask you to do the hardest job of all, which is to choose your favorite science demonstration. And I will pass my hand over each contestant's head. And by the strength of your applause, we will crown this year's first Iron Science teacher. So let's hear for Paul Doherty and the Cheerio Effect. Tammy Cook Endres with Osmosis and the Naked Egg. Lori Lambertson with Iron in Your Cereal. And Eric Muller with Egg in a Bottle. I've checked with our trusty cameraman, Ron Hipschmidt, and this year's first Iron Science Teacher of the Year is a tie between Lori Lambertson and Eric Muller. Proving once again that the best way to win Iron Science Teacher is to make a mess. Thank you all for coming. Please join us next week for another episode of Iron Science Teacher. Have fun out there.